Hey guys, Drifter here. Today I've got a video for you about cryptocurrency, but I wanted to open up with a quote from quantum physicist Richard Feynman. He famously once said, "Anybody who claims to understand quantum theory is either lying or crazy." And I have the same opinion about cryptocurrency. Anybody that you see on the internet who claims to know everything about cryptocurrency is either lying or crazy with no in between. Today we're going to be talking a lot about cryptocurrency. I'm going to go over the basics of how it works. I'm going to offer some opinions and make some predictions about the future, especially the future of our government money supply, our paper money, and our fiat money system. But I want all of you to seriously reconsider taking financial advice from random gamers on YouTube, and don't trust anyone who claims to fully know everything about this new financial sector. I most certainly don't. It's incredibly complex. It's brand new. It is the cutting edge. It is the wild west of investing money. And to me, that's what makes it fun, but that also makes it high risk. So invest responsibly. If this makes any of you want to buy cryptocurrency, I did sign up for the Webull affiliate program. That one video I did months ago about the basics of investing got their attention. They invited me to their affiliate program. So I have an affiliate link down there below to the app that I trade most of my cryptocurrency on. It's a basic thing. If you sign up, I get a free stock, you get a free stock, we both get a win, and Webull gets a win because you've invested some money in them and hopefully they retain you for a long run customer. You can trade crypto with Webull as well, including Dogecoin. So the sign up link is below, and I would encourage you to do this if you have spare money and want to play with it, not your rent money, not your important money, not your retirement money. Guys, please be responsible. I trade crypto only in my spare fun money. It's literally adult gambling for me. It's not a retirement strategy, but it can still be very fun. All right, so let's start off with the basics of cryptocurrency. At its simplest form, cryptocurrency is digital currency, like internet dollars. Not necessarily internet dollars like the dollars in your bank account, which is digital, but more of a totally different non-US dollar type of currency. It has no physical location, no dedicated secured host, no government-backed value, and the value that cryptocurrency has typically is only there because there's some kind of demand for it. Somebody's willing to trade a more traditional money supply or service for this cryptocurrency. For today, we're going to be talking about the demand for cryptocurrency outside of government control a lot. And speaking of control, let's talk about why cryptocurrency doesn't use a central server or authority for its values. And yes, you heard that correctly. Crypto has no central hub. It's not like PayPal or your bank account or Venmo or whatever, where there's one company and one server and they all know what they're doing. And, you know, they have like a master account manager. This has absolutely no main hub. Coinbase is not the king of cryptocurrency. Nobody is. It's kind of like a peer-to-peer bank that's been democratized via the internet, which is a very bizarre thing. And what basically makes cryptocurrency work is two things working in conjunction with each other. The first is a distributed ledger, and the second is blockchain, which is basically kind of an advanced distributed ledger. So pretty much any digital currency is subject to double spending because it's all zeros and ones. When I hand you my physical $1 bill, it moves from one hand to another like a physical object, and you can see it and observe it and you don't have it. But a digital currency, you could just tell the computer on the other end some information and it wouldn't know any better and be like, yes, money received, and you still have money in your account. Hacking, cheating, whatever. So why doesn't this happen with Bitcoin? Well, Bitcoin makes use of a distributed ledger, which is a really fancy word for an accounting of who owns what exactly, and it's also spread apart across multiple blocks. So not one person owns the entire ledger of all Bitcoin transactions, but lots of people own multiple blocks or chunks of it. This blockchain is a super complicated math algorithm that is essentially a cryptographic distributed ledger that I'm not going to get bogged down in the math today. I'll put a little video over here on this side showing you what it would look like if you were to do these calculations by hand. Needless to say, it's extremely complicated, and like very few of us truly get all of the little steps that are going on, or those of us that don't have advanced math degrees. The important part about it is that it's cryptographic or secure by design such that it's very difficult to manipulate. It is almost perfectly stable on its own, though not totally stable. There was an issue once where Ethereum got split into half between Ethereum and Ethereum Classic by people exploiting a little quirk of the algorithm, but it's stable in the same way that your Wi-Fi connection is stable, that your sign into Google is secure. It's very difficult to manipulate, perhaps even more difficult than our regular physical money. And basically each block in this blockchain of difficult to compute, difficult to fake, and difficult to take advantage of cryptographic blocks is a giant ledger of who owns what. And if you think about it, a bank is also kind of like a giant ledger. When you put your $100 in the bank, they don't seal it in a block of concrete and wait for you. They just write it down in their ledger, or nowadays on a computer, letting it know who owes what and who owns what. And that's exactly what cryptocurrency is, except instead of the bank owning the list of accounts, we all own it. If you have a Bitcoin or part of a Bitcoin, then you own a part of the entire ledger of where people have stored their money and what they're doing with it. And we all contribute to that with our computational power, which is the perfect segue into coin mining. So coin mining effectively does two jobs. Number one is to verify the ledger and keep it intact for everyone so that nobody can cheat the ledger, add money, take money away. It's a really nice, safe way to verify that when you're checking your ledger that it's the way that it's supposed to be. And number two, the important part is that it expands upon that ledger and adds extra room to add new coins into the market and add new transactions onto the ledger that everybody can, again, keep track of. Mining the coins, as we showed before, is computationally intense, but doing so effectively keeps this bank open because we're doing all of the work of the bank ourselves. And this is a bank that no one individual person owns, which is the most important part of this video, and I think it's what we're going to be talking the most about at the end, but I got to get through all this other stuff first. As I mentioned before, it takes a ton of computational power. It only gets harder and harder with time, and Bitcoin mining is basically a computation power and electricity and resources arms race. If you want to mine Bitcoin, you can do that and turn a profit, but you're going to need a more efficient mining algorithm, which is super rare if you're not like a college level mathematician with a PhD and some specialty in cryptography, perhaps a massive computing power on your own, like being at a university and having access to a supercomputer. Funny story, most universities ban coin mining on their supercomputers because the nerdy kids that were into it when it first came out did it just constantly and made buku money and wasted crazy electricity. And that's our third thing that you need, is a lot of very cheap or essentially free electricity, because if you've seen a coin mining rig, it's like 1,000 3090 graphics cards in these giant server banks and chains back to back. They're super hot, they're overclocked, running full blast, liquid cooling, nitrogen air, just anything that you can do to crank computational power out of these GPUs to mine more coins. And it uses an absurd amount of electricity, not just the electricity to run the cards, which is quite a lot, but also the electricity to cool the building and keep everything from melting. That's why, in my opinion, mining coins is not profitable for the vast majority of people unless you have a near free source of electricity and you don't mind destroying your graphics card or cards. Very few people have access to these things, and even if you did have access to these things, it's very polluting. Side note, there's a lot of gaming companies out there and sponsors that'll have this like, yeah, dude, run this thing on your computer and it'll mine Bitcoins in the background and you'll make $50 a month. Don't do that. You'll burn more than $50 in electricity, I promise you. But this last topic of wasting electricity is why Elon and gang have kind of turned against the crypto market. Because it uses so much electricity, it is inherently bad for our environment. If you think about where our electricity comes from, the electricity for all the dozens of electronics around me, or where you charged your phone from, or what manufactured it, odds are that at least a significant portion of that was generated by burning fossil fuels. And we use so much electricity mining Bitcoin, I think it's the equivalent output of Argentina every single day, and this is growing every single day. In the next 10 years, it's going to be the same energy output as maybe something like France or Germany for just Bitcoin itself, which is just terrifying. And that's effectively wasted energy on imaginary internet coins. And most of that energy, again, probably would have come from fossil fuels somewhere in the world. Of course, there'd be green energy mixed in somewhere, but it all pollutes a little bit and we can do better things with our resources. That's one of the biggest things that kind of turns me off about crypto, is that it is inherently bad for the environment. Just its existence is energy wasteful and it's bad for the environment. But the same thing is true of almost every modern computing technology that we deal with. And that's kind of the basics of Bitcoin itself. It's internet money. It has value because people want it. It is a self-replicating ledger of accounts like a bank, except nobody owns the bank. But each coin kind of has its own trick. Bitcoin's the simple one. That's mostly what it does. Some of these coins, like Ethereum, store permanent financial information, Some of them store medical information. Some of them contribute to cloud computing problems. Some of the stuff that you go through to mine a coin for some of these are doing DNA folding or some sort of advanced computing problems. Some of them are verifying bank transactions. Some of them are keeping game servers up. Some of them are investing in a charity somehow. There's some of them, like I think Algorand, which I bought a little bit of, is paying a fixed interest rate because they baked that into the currency itself. Some are pegged to a physical currency. Some are designed to be much more efficient to mine, and thus environmentally friendly. Some are designed to be incredibly difficult to mine. So it's literally a computational power arms race. And this list can go on forever. In order to compete with Bitcoin, every altcoin has something that it's doing different to, you know, differentiate itself in the market and look appealing. If you want to know what each coin does on any investment site, Coinbase, Webull, Robinhood, whatever you guys are using, most of the time you can click and see a description of the coins and it'll tell you what your computational power is going towards. As you can see, all of this is very complicated and we really skipped and skimmed and simplified a lot. I know there's a lot of crypto experts out there and those internet experts always waiting in the YouTube comments whose heads are probably exploding. They're furiously writing messages about the things that I said that were technically wrong. Guys, I know, but it's a complicated subject and I don't want to spend like 10 hours going through all the math on a video. So to be a true cryptocurrency expert, which I am not, you need to be well-versed in cryptography, advanced forms of math, cryptography economics, regular economics, hardware development sciences, and you need to be pretty abreast of government regulations and tax laws, also government predictions on how they're going to react to this. And anybody who tells you they know everything about cryptocurrency is either lying or crazy. That's not to say there aren't some very smart people out there. There are much more educated people out there than myself. There are some people you should listen to. There are probably 100 to 1 people you should listen to versus shouldn't listen to, but I think that's true of the internet and life in general. So be careful and be wary of all these little weird get-rich-quick schemes. However, this is the, like I said before, the Wild West of finance. This is totally uncharted territory for everyone, every government, every person, every investor, every genius and every moron. They are all in totally unexplored territory and nobody really knows what's gonna happen next. However, oddly, all of this uncertainty and risk has stopped very few people from investing in crypto because they want decentralization of their currency. A lot of times really risky things like this kind of turn investors away, but the risk, the reward that people are seeing in the long run is higher than all of these crazy risks because there is a demand for a supply of money completely independent of banks and governments. And that demand is so high that it's outperforming any and all regulations that are rapidly being placed on cryptocurrency. So a brief sidetrack here, we all know the US dollar used to be based on some amount of gold, and I don't remember what the amounts were, $1 is 1 ounce of gold or something like that. And then eventually we got off the gold standard and started trading fiat money, otherwise known as debt money or government-backed money, or money that's as worth as much as the US government is worth kind of money. But that also means that the money that we spend and trade and use is subject to government control and bank control and oversight, at least to some extent. Most of us watching this video are probably in Western countries, and Western countries are content to mostly leave the money supply alone, but they do control it. Cryptocurrency bypasses all of that control and oversight and lets people do whatever they want with their currency. They can choose what currency they want. The value of the currency they choose will be determined by how it's mined, or if it's doing anything important while it's being mined, more accurately, who's trading it and what they're trading it for, and all of these factors, and not anything that the government says. A cryptocurrency isn't really going to be based on faith in the government or a government debt scheme or a gold standard or anything like that. Great way to think about this is something kind of scary that happened early in 2021. Most of you probably remember the US Capitol riots, where when we were trying to confirm the election of Joe Biden, a large group of protesters stormed the Rotunda building and the Capitol in order to try to overthrow the government, maybe execute some senators. And it was people died. It was a big mess. That's a whole different political video that we're not going to get into today. But that was a scary day in US history. And that's a day where Democrats and Republicans alike both saw our government shake under a very small threat. And confidence went way down. Now, it was for different reasons for both groups, mind you, but they saw the most powerful government in the world just crumble under the tiniest of threats. And in that moment, you saw the value of the US dollar decline worldwide, but more importantly, cryptocurrency exploded that day. Bitcoin went super cuckoo bananas crazy to the moon, to the Mars, beyond hanging out in Pluto land. And that's because people on that day thought, oh my, there might not be as much future in this US dollar and this debt-backed money as I thought, and perhaps I should move it somewhere else. And right now the best alternative is cryptocurrency, because you kind of control it and manage it. So clearly the demand for this is very high. Now, most of us live in a society that has been capitalist for a very long time. Most of you watching this video, I know some of you are watching from socialist or communist countries, but you probably still understand the economics to some degree. But we pretty much do whatever we want with our money regardless of laws as a civilization. And that's not something that I'm encouraging. I'm not telling you to break the law or anything like that. But if you look at the long run of human history and even current times, most people, or we'll just say organizations, will do what they want. All of the laws in the world and crackdowns did not stop the drug trade one bit. Busting and arresting as many women as you wanted did not stop sex work. Adding fines did not stop corporate polluting. It didn't stop, nothing stopped corporate police and private police, both during barren capitalism in the 1880s and in the 1950s when we were having labor union riots and stuff like that. All of the regulations and fines and jail time didn't stop effectively buying politicians. So you know that when there's a demand for something, even if it's the worst thing in the world, like horrible drugs like methamphetamines or whatever, people are going to find a way to buy it. And it's a part of our culture at this point. No rule is going to stop us from spending money on what it is we really want. And interestingly, one of the things we really wanted was a money with less control so we could do more of that. And Bitcoin was the was the alternative for that. When it initially showed up, it was very deeply entwined with drug trade and the Silk Road and all that kind of stuff. And then it started moving out into other economic sectors and people with different ideologies and stuff. And as of right now, Bitcoin or cryptocurrency is a kind of money that you can do whatever you want with in many different ways, not only completely illegal stuff, but legal stuff and different weird economic and investment strategies and stuff, just very outside the norm. Thus, in our society, where money is ultimately king and people are willing to take crazy risk and do all sorts of stuff to try to make more of it, there is a massive demand for this new alternative money. And in my opinion, that's why cryptocurrency is booming. The scary thing is that I think cryptocurrency, or at least something similar to it, is probably going to be the future of all currency. I don't think 200 years from now people are going to be trading gold-based money or debt-based fiat coins, but rather some version of cryptocurrency. It may not be crypto as we know it. It might be something totally different under a different name, but inspired by crypto. But I think that what people are going to be trading as a commodity, as a store of value, is going to be computing power and raw information, which is exactly what a cryptocurrency encapsulates. And both of those two things are worth more than gold in our current society, probably worth more than all the gold on all the transistors that's used to create all those calculations. Data, information, faster processing, ledgers, machine learning algorithms, all of these things are the most valuable things in existence today, and that's only going to grow as we become an even more technologically advanced society. Of course, if we don't destroy ourselves with global warming first, which cryptocurrency is kind of contributing to, but that's a different problem for a different day that we already briefly addressed. So what you're buying with crypto would be, instead of a government debt money, it would be a summation of work and resources, perhaps a true summation of work and resources that you know the exact value for. And I think that the market force of this and the demand of this for people that want this is higher than any government can control, at least anymore. Maybe 10, 20 years ago, the government could have put its foot down and crushed this when it was absolutely nothing. But we are past the point of no return. Even if the entire crypto market tanks tomorrow and we all lose all our money and all of you hate me for investing in crypto or whatever, it'll come back up in the longest of long runs because the customer is always right, which means that you just can't beat market forces. You can't tell people they don't want what they want. When they want something and they're willing to spend money on it, that want will always win in the long run, no matter what it is. It might take decades, might take 2 weeks, might take 300 years, but at some point in the future, I think that most of our money, probably not all, but the majority of our money will be crypto-based. However, as for now, if you're looking for me on advice on investing in crypto, I'll tell you the same thing I told you in the very beginning when I mentioned the little Webull affiliate link. It's extremely volatile, it's unstable, it's still subject to a ton of regulations. There's new coins coming and going every day. Every time Elon Musk tweets, it does something good or bad. I think if you look at it, the long run is definitely there. The trend is upward stable, but the day-to-day, month-to-month, week-to-week is all over the place. So if you want to invest in cryptocurrency, I would tell you to do that with your side money, with your play money, with your I've got a spare $100 and I'm not gonna, you know, miss it if I lose it all kind of money. Don't bet your rent on this. There were so many people that bet their rent money on Dogecoin and Bitcoin and stuff that just went bust. Don't bet your retirement future on this. If you're gonna do that, if you want to retire, open a Vanguard account and buy index funds. Don't just dump it all into crypto. But if you don't mind the risk and you want to have a little fun, crypto is a really easy and fun way to get into the whole like investing thing, and you can kind of see the future coming. Guys, that is all for this video. I hope that you enjoyed it. I hope that you learned something useful. If you did, don't forget to like, favorite, and subscribe. Drifter out. I wanted to add this little bit here on the end of the video talking about should you invest in volatility and blah, blah, blah. Literally the very next day after I finished recording what you watched, which was on May 18th, Bitcoin took another sharp nosedive and plummeted down into the abyss down here, temporarily at least being worth about $35,000. If you're looking for true investment advice on cryptocurrency, my advice would be that it's extremely volatile. It's a high-risk investment, and it needs to fit your risk tolerance. If you're okay with risking all of your money on something and potentially losing all of it and never seeing it again, sure, Bitcoin's great. If you love these big up-and-down swings, these big, crazy, volatile highs and lows, and you want to try to time them and gamble, great. Bitcoin's lovely for you. If you think Bitcoin is going to be the best place for your retirement money, mm-mm. Is Bitcoin going to be the place where you should pay your rent? Mm-mm. Bitcoin should literally be your casino money. Right now, people are trying to shore it up with this whole buy the dip movement on Twitter. And yeah, I mean, people will buy the dip, I'm sure. I'm trying to buy the dip. I'm buying little bits of it all the way down, trying to guess where the bottom is. I've been wrong so far and lost the significant. It just went down more while we were recording. But the point of all of this is that crypto is fun. There's a lot of opportunity to make money in crypto, buying and flipping and trading, but it's really difficult to do. So I would recommend this for more experienced investors, and I would recommend this for people with a high risk tolerance and people with some spare money. And I guess you can actually see now, since I'm recording like this, about what day I actually record these videos and how long it takes for me to edit them and get them up on YouTube. Because I think that this video is supposed to go live about 6 days from now, and I guarantee you in 6 days, this graph will have done something totally, radically, unpredictably different. So good luck, young investors.